Yes.
Big sniffle.
Okay, I wondered about
you
that.
You guys harmonized so beautiful, Kelly.
Dan. Yeah, it was. Yeah, it's the room acoustics, you know. Yeah, that's good. Good, 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 good. You're a brat.
Thank you, it's a gift.
Ah, right. That, yeah, you're reminding me of that one. Yeah. Yeah, we're going to do this song in E.
Yeah.
Doing it in D. I think Al wound up playing the whole song in E.
He
did. You know.
That one, am I here?
He's focused on his fingers, not his ears.
Yeah, I've never figured out how to turn this tuner off.
Oh, yeah? I wonder.
Hi. Bless you.
Look at that. Here it is. Good. Okay.
Pardon me. Just vocal warm up.
Yeah, the best.
You got a minute. You got four.
I'm going to close that door.
Oh, thanks, Shelley. Yeah. Hey, Carl. You know what I do when I get bored? I get in my car and I go to the Walmart parking lot and I find the best parking spot. I take it and I sit there with the reverse lights on. Boy, talk about people watching. That's fun.
So what kind of car do you drive?
It's got a lot of dents on it now. Yeah. Hi, Grace. How are you? Hello, David. Good day, indeed. Hey, it's still light out. How'd that happen?
Woohoo.
Yeah.
Oh, my gosh. Oh, yeah. Yeah, one of the guys thought it was like 6 o'clock, but it was 7. Boy, oh, boy. Just what I need, one less hour of sleep. Land of the sleep deprived.
I have never figured out how we're saving daylight.
Well, that's what the guy said. He said, daylight saving time is a joke. Look, it's dark out. We're not saving any light. I thought, yeah, that's kind of smart, actually. It's kind of wise.
Hey, they had a meeting about daylight saving time. Who?
Who?
Yeah.
Who?
Oh, they did.
They?
Yeah, but they said it was a waste of time.
Oh, wow. Nice one. Yeah, I decided to procrastinate, but I just haven't got around to it yet. Yeah. Oh, good to see you. We're couple minutes away from going out to the world, but you guys are here, and it's good to see you. Wow, this is great. I'll say it again when we're on the air, but we're next week. There's a kids club vacation, like a spring break Bible school happening here, so we won't be doing hymn sing next week. Yeah, I know. We won't be. I know. You'll have to go online and play this one back again, or something, you know.
Oh, we could come to your house.
That's right. No, I won't be there. Oh. I won't be there. But, yeah. Yeah. No, that would scare the daylights out of me if you guys all showed up at my place. It's like, Leslie, look. Put on the coffee and the tea.
And the donuts.
Yeah.
Thank you, Carl.
Oh, we got some great songs. We have some awesome songs. I'm going to tell you all about them tonight. Oh, we're good, eh, Carl? Right on. Yeah, it's Tuesday, March the 12th, 2024, and here we are at Hymn Sing. It's like about the 60th or 70th episode of Hymn Sing, and we're just loving doing this. Big shout out to everyone who's online there, all our friends in Scotland. Hello, Ian. And you folks, and Joanne, and all the people in Kimberley who are watching right now, happy skiing,
and Clearwater.
Clearwater, yes,
yeah.
and all the way out in Lake Country, they're watching us,
yeah.
and the people at Mill Creek, and just hi, it's really good to have you here. We're going to do something a little different. We did this a while ago, and backed by popular demand. We chose a bunch of songs, and instead of having a little sermonette, we're going to talk about the songs, about these great songs. But before I start, I want to remind you and let you know that next week we won't be live here. We've got it's spring break, and there's a kids camp happening here, kids Bible school, so the stage will be commandeered. So we're taking next week off, but we'll be back at it the week of Easter, which is the week after that. So no hymn sing, no live hymn sing here next week on the 19th?
Yep.
19th, yeah. But if you want to come, you can come anyway and sit in the parking lot. And
with your reverse lights.
With your reverse lights on and see what happens. It might be fun. Yeah. So this song is a Christian hymn that was written in 1878 by a guy named Elisha Hoffman. He was a Presbyterian minister, and this song actually became a marching song for the Salvation Army. It's been recorded by many notable artists, including Johnny Cash, Alan Jackson, and Randy Travis. Great guys. And this pastor pastored several churches. His longest post was for 33 years in Michigan. And it was during those years that he wrote about 2,000 hymns. And Elisha Hoffman. And among his most popular are songs like What a Wonderful Savior, Enough for Me, Leaning on the Everlasting Arms, and this song, which is called Are You Washed in the Blood of the Lamb? I know. This song is cool because it contains many Bible references and allusions, including they have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. That's from Revelation, which we're studying right now in church. The first verse refers to the cleansing power of the blood of Christ. The second one refers to having fellowship with Christ. And the last verse is about laying aside our garments that are stained with sin because they've been washed clean, whiter than snow, by the blood of the Lamb. So the question asks in this, that him asks is, like if you ask a person today, are you going to heaven? They'll quietly say, yes. And then you'll say, well, why do you think you're going to heaven? They'll say, well, because I lived a good life, or I volunteered and helped the needy, or I attend church all the time, or I live by the golden rule. And those examples are fine, but they are works, and it's not by works how we get there. We get there by the blood of Christ, by grace and God's provision. And 1 John 1:7, if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus, his son, cleanses us from all sin. So here's the song that's all about that, from that was written in the late 1800s by Elisha Hoffman.
Curse.
Yeah? No words up there? Oh, there they are.
Magic.
Ah, he was Magic. Holding off as a big surprise. The reveal. Oh. There they are. Awesome. Have you been to Jesus for the cleansing power? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you fully trusting in His grace this hour? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood, in the soul-cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb?
Are you walking daily by the Savior's side? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Do you rest each moment in the crucified? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood, in the soul-cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb?
So lay aside the garments that are stained with sin and be washed in the blood of the Lamb. There's a fountain flowing for the soul unclean. Oh, be washed in the blood of the Lamb. Are you washed in the blood, in the soul-cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood, in the soul-cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? I know, I fooled you. Yep. We didn't do that in rehearsal, but we did it there. We call that the bluegrass ending.
So we love singing with you. Yes, he'll just do stuff like that, and we just got to go with him, you know.
I crave your pardon, and I ask that you forgive me, and Jesus will cleanse me of all unrighteousness there. This next beautiful, beautiful hymn was actually, they don't know who wrote it. For over 300 years, Christians have sung and cherished this song. It's called Fairest Lord Jesus. And it's gone through an evolution. The hymn was copied from a Jesuit manuscript in 1662 in Munster, Germany. And it appeared in the Munster Gesangbuch, which is like the monster singing book. I guess, if you translate it loosely, a Catholic hymn book. The tune was different from what we know now. And then in 1842, a guy named Heinrich Hoffmann von Fallersleben, which translates to Henry Hoffmann von Fallersleben, compiled a collection of sacred songs, and he paired the text, the German text, with a tune he claimed was sung by haymakers out in the field. Yeah. So then the hymn was published again by an American, Richard Willis, who included it in his collection of hymns, and he renamed it the Crusaders' Hymn. I know, the Crusaders' Hymn. Due to the false assumption that soldiers sang it on their way to Jerusalem during the Crusades. False assumption. So he published three stanzas along with the English translation and called it Fairest Lord Jesus. And then the Hungarian composer Franz Liszt famously employed the Crusaders' Hymn in his 1864 oratorio called The Legend of St. Elizabeth, which was about St. Elizabeth of Thuringia, the wife of the German King Louis IV. This is all very historical and factual and very interesting, isn't it? Exciting stuff.
Like that.
Yeah. So after this composition, more and more variants of Fairest Lord Jesus popped up. And recently, many hymnal committees have abandoned the traditional tune named Crusader's Hymn due to the, you know, that was not our finest hours in Christianity. But this takes us to the present day, where multiple translations and tunes currently circulate. However, the hymn has stood the test of time for over 300 years, and I'm sure will continue to be used, because this tune enchants the heart, and the text transcends time. And what could be more beautiful than meadows in springtime, sunbeams or twinkling stars? Well, Jesus, our ruler of all nature, he shines purer than all the heavens, all the angels that heaven can boast. And that's all I have written about it, so now we're going to sing it. This is one of my favorites. It's a beautiful, beautiful song. Fairest Lord Jesus, ruler of all nature, O thou of God and man the Son, thee will I cherish, thee will I honor, thou my soul's glory, joy and crown.
Fair are the meadows, fairer still the woodlands, robed in the blooming garb of spring. Jesus is purer, who makes the woeful heart to cease.
Fair is the sunshine, fair still the moonlight, and all the twinkling starry host. Jesus shines brighter, Jesus shines purer than all the angels heaven can boast.
Beautiful
now and forevermore be thine. Glory and honor, praise, adoration, now and forevermore be thine.
Oh, that's a beautiful song, and as beautiful as it is, Jesus is more beautiful. I'm going to move closer to you guys with the added thing of I can actually see Shelly now. Hi, Shell.
Hi, Curtis. You're there.
Eye contact is so important when you're playing music, isn't it, Doug?
Yeah, especially with, from the eyes to the music.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Eye contact with the music is great. Written during a time of revival in 1858, this song echoes the Bible's call for believers to stand up and serve the Lord. This hymn calls us to stand up and put on the gospel armor and serve Jesus courageously. During the great revival of 1858, it came to be known that revival was called the Work of God in Philadelphia. And it was based on the words of a Reverend Dudley A. Ting. T-Y-N-G.
He was one of the most active ministers in that revival. It said that when he preached on March the 30th, 1858, at the noonday prayer meeting in a place called Jane's Hall, 5,000 men listened to that sermon. And from the text, "Go now, ye that are men, and serve the Lord." And before the closing of that meeting, over 1,000 of them were saved. The man was a preacher. He was an evangelist. A few days later, he left his study for a moment and went out to the barn where a mule was working, harnessed to a machine, shelling corn. He patted the mule on the head, and unfortunately his sleeve got caught in the cogs of the wheel, and his arm was horribly, horribly mangled. And after a painful but short illness, death finally claimed him. This great orator, this great man of God, this great preacher. As he was dying, his father asked him if he had any message for his fellow ministers in the revival. He replied, "Let us all stand up for Jesus." Pretty much his dying words. The following Sunday, Ting's friend, Dr. George Duffield Jr., preached a memorial sermon based on Ephesians 6:14, which reads, "Stand your ground, putting on the belt of truth and the body armor of God's righteousness." And then he wrote this hymn based on Ting's dying words. Some of the lyrics in this song echo Ephesians 6, which speaks of putting on the whole armor of God so that we might be able to stand firm in the Lord and persevere in the battles which we fight in this life. So as we sing and listen to these lyrics, consider the call that we have to stand up for Jesus.
Stand up for Jesus, ye soldiers of the cross. Lift high his royal banner, it must not suffer loss. From victory unto victory, his army shall he lead. Till every foe is vanquished and Christ is Lord indeed.
Stand up for Jesus, the trumpet.
That serve him against unnumbered foe. Let courage rise with danger and strength to strength oppose. Stand up for Jesus, stand in his strength alone. The arm of flesh will fail you, ye dare not trust your own. Put on the gospel armor, each piece put on with prayer. Where duty calls or danger, be never wanting there.
Stand up. Strife will not be long. There
That is so, so rich, so rich. To him that overcometh, a crown of life shall be. This next song, oh, it's that one, okay. This next song, the author was Annie Sherwood Hawks. She wrote over 400 hymns in her lifetime. She was born in 1835. And she had a love for writing poetry, and her poems were published in local newspapers while she was still a teenager. And Dr. Robert Lowry was her pastor at a Baptist church in Brooklyn, New York, and he encouraged her gift of poetry, and he promised, because he was a musician, he promised to write music for her poems and encouraged her to continue writing prose. Interestingly, a lot of these hymns, the words came first, and sometimes it was years before the music was put to them. They were poems. They were love letters, love poems to God. I've written songs in my time, and it's usually music and lyrics together, but it's interesting that these songs inspired the music, you know? In 1872, Annie wrote her most famous hymn. And toward the end of her life, she provided a detailed account of how she did it and what it meant to her. So this is her words, talking about how she wrote this song. Whenever my attention is called to it, I'm conscious of great satisfaction in the thought that I was permitted to write the hymn, I Need Thee Every Hour. And that it was wafted out to the world on the wings of love and joy, rather than under the stress of a great personal sorrow, with which it has so often been associated in the minds of those who sing it. I remember well the morning, many years ago, when in the midst of the daily cares of my home, then in a distant city, I was so filled with a sense of nearness to the Master that, wondering how one could live without him, either in joy or pain, these words, I need thee every hour, were ushered into my mind, the thought at once taking full possession of me. Seating myself by the open window in the balmy air of the bright June day, I caught my pencil and the words were soon committed to paper, almost as they are being sung today. It was only by accident, it would seem, that they were set to music a few months after and sung for the first time at a Sunday school. From there, they were taken further west and sung by thousands before the echo came back to me, thrilling my heart with surprise and gladness. For myself, the hymn was rather prophetic rather than expressive of my own experience at the time it was written, and I do not understand why it so touched the great throbbing heart of humanity. It was not until long years after, when the shadow fell over my way, the shadow of a great loss, that I understood something of the comforting in the words I had been permitted to write and give out to others in my hours of sweet security and peace. Now when I hear them sung, as I have sometimes by hundreds of voices in chorus, I find it difficult to think they were ever consciously my own thought or penned by my own hand. The girl could write. Regarding the loss she said she experienced in her life, that was when her husband died at the age of 55. This song resonates with Christians across time and space because it speaks to a deeply rooted need to feel the presence of God in times of distress. I need thee every hour, most gracious Lord. No tender voice like thine can peace afford. I need thee, oh, I need thee. Every hour I need thee. Oh, bless me now, my Savior. I come to thee. I need thee every
come quickly and abide, or life is vain. I need thee, oh, I need thee. Every hour I need thee. Oh, bless me now, my Savior. I come to thee.
Teach me thy will and thy rich promises in me fulfill.
I need thee, oh, I need thee. Every hour I need thee. Oh, bless me now, my Savior. I come to thee. I need thee, oh, I need thee. Every hour I need thee. Oh, bless me now, my Savior. I come to thee.
This next song, there's a story to it, but there's also a story, a personal one, because it's very, this song is very meaningful to a number of us who lost a good friend some years ago while camping, and we were all singing hymns one day, and people kept joining. You know, I said, okay, we had a songbook, and we'll go around the circle, and everybody pick a song. And our friend, Ron, he was sitting in a chair, and then someone would come, and he'd move over, so he kept missing his turn to pick a song. And I finally said, which song should we sing, Ron? He said, all of them. I said, okay, we can do that. What do you want now? And he chose this song here. And then that night he went to glory. And I'll never forget that. In 1945, a young Christian businessman stood one evening in an evangelistic service in Dallas, Texas, and told how he had learned a valuable lesson from a small child. The gentleman stated that his business for a number of months had been in a steady decline, and it looked as if it would completely fail. Since the situation seemed beyond his ability to understand or control, he found himself slipping into despondency, discouragement, and feelings of despair. He related how one day, for a period of diversion, he decided to get in his car and drive out to the countryside. He traveled for miles out beyond the busy streets, into the country. He stopped his car on a lonely road and continued on foot. And soon he found himself on a deserted, out-of-the-way trail, where eventually he came upon a dilapidated cottage. It was in great disrepair, with some of the windows replaced with cardboard. Out front was a young girl playing with a doll. Although the stuffing in the doll was protruding in several places, the child seemed to be content and happy. He approached the front yard, keeping his distance for fear of frightening the child, and asked, "Little girl, would you tell me how you can be happy living in such a house? It is broken down and the windows are out and the doll you have in your hand is broken with stuffing coming. How can you be happy?" The little girl looked up with a smiling face and a gesturing hand said, "Mister, my daddy just came into a lot of money, and he is building us a brand new mansion just over that hilltop." The young businessman testified that those words pierced his heart. He realized for the first time that though his earthly business was faltering, his heavenly Father had greater things in store for him. It was as though he heard God saying, "Son, don't you know that I have a mansion prepared for you just beyond those clouds?" The young businessman concluded his story by telling how he went back home with a new determination to live for God and let the heavenly Father take care of the business. Ira Stanfill, who was a famed songwriter, was in the audience that evening. He was so moved by the story, he went home, still thinking about what he had heard. He rose early the next morning, went to his piano, and wrote the song Mansion Over the Hilltop. I'm satisfied with just a cottage below, a little silver and a little gold. But in that city where the ransom will shine, I want a gold one, that silver line. I've got a mansion just over the hilltop, in that bright land where we'll never go. And someday yonder we will never more wander, but walk on streets that are pure as gold.
Though often tempted, tormented and tested, and like the prophet, my pillow was gold. And though I find here no permanent dwelling, I know you'll give me a mansion my own. I've got a mansion just over the hilltop, in that bright land where we'll never go. And someday yonder we will never more wander, but walk on streets that are pure as gold.
Don't think me poor or deserted or lonely, I'm not discouraged, I'm heaven bound. I'm but a pilgrim in search of a city. I want a mansion, a harp and a crown. I've got a mansion just over the hilltop, in that bright land where we'll never go. And someday yonder we will never more wander, but walk on streets that are pure as gold. I've got a mansion just over the hilltop, in that bright land where we'll never grow old. And someday yonder we will never more wander, but walk on streets that are pure as gold.
Isn't that a cool story that just adds on to the story? God is good. God is good. So a lot of these hymns were written in the 1800s, the 1700s, the 1600s, even before Ernie was born. And a little bit. But there are some that are collaborations. There's some that have been written fairly recently. And this one surprised me that it was written in 2001. A collaboration between a lyricist and a tunesmith, Stuart Townend and Keith Getty. And this is often attributed as one of the best modern examples of storytelling conveying the power of the gospel. And it was co-written by these guys. And Getty, the fellow, says he was struggling to understand and fully embrace his faith amid an unbelieving, universalist, and multi-religious culture. Wow, that sounds like a thinker. And he grew up in Durham, England, by the way. They think out there. And it was a journey to believe in the uniqueness of Christ, the scriptures, and the gospel story. But by the time I came through this, meaning the writing of this song, my faith was stronger
And I really wanted to write songs for the church that brought the full, rich, life-giving story of the gospel into believers' hearts and minds. See how these stories are inspired by God? They come from Him through the artists. And God gifts these artists and then inspires them. I then had the privilege of connecting with the songwriter Stuart Townend, who had penned the hymn, How Deep the Father's Love for Us. That's a fairly modern hymn too, and isn't that a beautiful song? So they met, they formed a relationship, and then they wrote this song together. Let's do a song that tells the whole story of Christ coming to earth, the whole gospel story in one song. Let's have as many verses as we want, and let's just go for it in the modern vernacular. So they started having melody ideas, and the first of which was penned on the back of an electricity bill. and they co-wrote this. Throughout this process was a deep desire to dig deep into the meaning of God's word and express it in poetic and memorable way. And they dove into the word to write this song. And the lyrics came to life. And after some fine tuning, they finally got together and this song was born. A song abounding in biblical truths. The exegesis of this song, if you will, involves no less than 231 scriptures. It's the Bible. It's the gospel in this song, which is called and the winner is In Christ Alone. Christ alone, my hope is found. He is the light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are stilled, when striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I'll stand.
In Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save, till on that cross as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied. For every sin on him was laid, here in the death of
the ground his body lay, light of the world by darkness slain, then bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave he rose again. And as he stands in victory, since curse has lost its grip on me, for I am his and he is mine, bought with the precious blood of Christ. Oh, 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 oh.
No guilt in life, no fear in death, this is the power of life's first cry to final breath. Jesus commands my destiny.
In Scotland, and all your friends watching him sing right now. This song was written by a Scottish physician, Dr. William Mackay, from the Clan Mackay. He was born in 1839 at the age of 17. Oh, no, I read that wrong. Those Scots are incredible people, aren't they? At the age of 17, he left his humble Scottish home to attend the University of Edinburgh to study medicine. His godly mother gave him a Bible in which she wrote his name and a verse of scripture. Away from home, he began his studies. But as time went by, he drifted further and further from the way he had been raised. He began drinking heavily. At a particularly low point in his life, to satisfy his thirst for whiskey, Mackay even pawned the Bible his mother had given him. Upon graduating from medical school, his first assignment was to work in a hospital emergency room. While working in this room, he became acquainted with human suffering. Occasionally, Mackay would witness the remarkable difference in the life of a person who had faith in Christ. Dr. Mackay said it was not strange for him to see the difference in the Christian because he'd been raised in a Christian home, of course, by a Christian, by godly parents. His own mother had led him to Christ as a young man and prayed often for her son. Yet the older that Dr. Mackay grew, the more wicked he became. That's a Scottish word, wicked. He believed he was in danger of becoming a thorough infidel. One day a young man, a mason's helper, was brought into the emergency room. He had fallen off a very tall scaffold and was in serious condition. William was assigned to the young man. It was soon determined that because of his serious injuries, his case was hopeless. All William could do was relieve the young man's pain as much as possible. Dr. Mackay asked the young man, "Do you have any relatives that we can notify of your injuries?" And the young man replied, "No, sir. I live alone in this world. However, would you please notify my landlady and ask her to come visit me? I owe her some money and want to pay her. Also, when she comes, ask her to bring me my book." "What book?" Dr. Mackay asked. "Oh, just tell her to bring the book. She will know what book I'm talking about," the young man responded. Dr. Mackay saw the young man several times a day while he was in the emergency room. He noticed a calm expression on the young man's face when he talked with him. Mackay guessed that the young man was a Christian, but did not want to talk about that with him or anyone else. The landlady brought the young man his book, and it was indeed a Bible. And the young man read it constantly. When he could not read it any longer, he just laid his Bible on his chest and hugged it. After 1 week, the young man died. Afterwards, Dr. Mackay was called to his room by the nurses to fill out the necessary paperwork. When one of the nurses asked Dr. Mackay, "What should I do with this Bible?" Dr. Mackay told the nurse that the young man had no relatives and that she could just give him the Bible and he would dispose of it. While the nurses tended to the body of the young man, Dr. Mackay opened up the front of the Bible and curiously looked inside. At the first few pages, suddenly he slammed the Bible closed with a strange look on his face. A nurse noticed Dr. McKay's countenance and asked, "Are you all right?" And Dr. McKay answered, "Yes, I'm going to my office. If you need me, you can call me there." He went to his office and shut the door and sat at his desk and opened the Bible again, and there it was, his mother's handwriting. The Bible was inscribed by, it was the very Bible that she had given him when he left home for medical school. I know. The young man must have bought the Bible from the pawn shop where Dr. Mackay had pawned it for drinking money. All the pages were well worn and some were loose and many verses had been underlined. This made the doctor think about how this Bible brought comfort to this dying young man and enabled him to die in peace and happiness. And with a sense of shame, he began to read the Bible. Some of the verses that were underlined, and many verses came back to him from his younger years, and the voice in his conscience could not be silenced any longer. And with tears in his eyes, he prayed for forgiveness and for God to restore him to the joy of salvation. Not long after Dr. McKay's Bible was miraculously returned to him, he wrote the words to this hymn, "Revive Us Again." With the return of that Bible, he quit the medical profession and entered theological college and became a pastor of a church in Scotland. He wrote 17 other hymns, but this is the only one that's still in use today.
We praise you, O God, for the Son of your love, for Jesus who died and is now gone above. Hallelujah, thine the glory. Hallelujah, amen. Hallelujah, thine the glory. Revive us again.
We praise you, O God, for your Spirit of light, who has showed us our Savior and banished our night. Hallelujah, thine the glory. Hallelujah, amen. Hallelujah, thine the glory. Revive us again.
All glory and praise to the Lamb that was slain, who has borne all our sin and has cleansed every stain.
Hallelujah, thine the glory. Hallelujah, amen.
Hallelujah, thine the glory. Revive us again.
Isn't that a cool story? I think I told that one before, but it's certainly worth repeating because it's beautiful and miraculous. You know, God uses coincidence
attention getter?
Well, that too, yeah. To remain anonymous, yeah. This next song was written by William J. Kirkpatrick and the lyrics by Louisa Hempstead, so a music writer and a lyric writer. It's included in many hymnals and is recorded by many artists. Louisa had poor health, but she eventually married and had a daughter named Lily. And when Lily was 4 years old, Louisa and her family were visiting Long Island Sound, and there was this young kid who was drowning. And Louisa's husband tried to save him, but they both passed away in the water. Terrible, terrible, terrible accident. And it's believed that this disaster provided the inspiration for the lyrics of this song, because out of her why struggle with God during the ensuing days glowed the meaningful words to the hymn, "'Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus." Louisa worked as a missionary in South Africa, and she married a South African named Robert. But she passed away after a long illness in 1917. But following her death, the Christians in Rhodesia said that, and I quote, "We miss her very much, but her influence goes on as our 5,000 converts continually sing this hymn in their native language. 'Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus."
Thank you. so sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take him at his word, just to rest upon his promise, just to know, thus saith the Lord. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I proved him o'er and o'er. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more.
Oh, how sweet to trust in Jesus, just to trust his cleansing blood, and in simple faith to plunge me neath the healing cleansing flood. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I prove him o'er and o'er. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, all for grace to trust him.
Precious Jesus, Savior, friend, and I know that thou art with me, will be with me to the end. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I proved him o'er and o'er. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, to trust him more. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I've proved him o'er and o'er. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him
more. This next song, our last song, this has been sweet, hasn't it? I love doing this, you know, to discovering how these songs are inspired, how are they written, the stories behind them. It's beautiful. It takes you back in time, and it connects us with other people from other times, this wonderful thing called humanity that God created. And here we are, just basking in these beautiful creations that God inspired in men and women throughout the centuries. So this is a Christian hymn, with music by William J. Kirkpatrick. No, sorry, that's the last song. Hang on. This song is attributed to a lady named Dorothy. My mom's name was Dorothy. Hi, Mom. God bless you. Dorothy A. Thrupp. And it's found in almost every Christian hymnal. And now, Dorothy lived between 1779 and 1847. That's about as old as your violin, isn't it? I think, you know, something like that. Getting there. It's one hymn that most church members can recognize across denominational lines. And what may surprise most of us is, however, that for such a well-known and well-loved hymn, we know little about how it was written or actually who its true author was. But whoever penned these words had a deep theological message to share. The mystery of the authorship of the words goes back to the 1830s when the hymn made its first appearances in Thrupp's Hymns for the Young, but without being attributed. So this gal compiled some songs, but there was no songwriter attributed to it. The words were directly applied to children, and the anonymous writer
obviously meant to use this four stanza hymn for teaching. It was more than 20 years later that the tune we presently know was composed by the American musician William Bradbury. He modified the original words, which were meant for children, and broadened the meaning to include all the congregation. Then, with some modernizing of the language, the text was standardized as it appears today. Since about 1830, this hymn has remained largely untouched. In fact, when the Methodist Book of Hymns shortened the chorus in 1966, the publisher received so many complaints that the full version was put back into it in a few years later. One has to wonder why this hymn has been so successful for nearly 200 years. And the most likely answer is found in the theology of the hymn. Since the focus of the original song was for young children, Thrupp would have wanted to encapsulate the essence and message of a caring Christ who loves all his children. And in the first stanza, we see Christ portrayed as a shepherd offering care and guidance to his flock, as well as preparing service for the Christian life. The second verse shows that we are not only possessed by Christ, but we are also in fellowship with him. He's our defender and our guide. He will hear us when we pray, and we will follow in his footsteps. And the author also alludes to lost sheep, especially in the phrase, "Seek us when we go astray." Some of you know the song already we're talking about. And there were four verses, but we usually, I've cut out the third one for whatever reason. So the third verse offers a wonderful picture of the salvation message of Christ, that no one is beyond the reach of God's love. And there is no sin too great to keep us separated from God. The picture we get from this hymn, and the reason it's such a defining song of the church, lies in the fact that it presents the fuller theology of Christian life in one song. The picture of the saving love and grace of God, the salvation message of God, God's fellowship with us, and the continuing service to God gives us a broader perspective of the Christian life. Now, Thrupp attempted to make the song accessible to children, and Bradbury presented it in a way that it's applicable to Christians of any age. And although this song may have some vague beginnings, it has a certain future, I'm sure, because of its message of hope, love, salvation, and Christian living. It's called "Savior, Like a Shepherd, Lead Us."
Savior, like a shepherd, lead us. Much we need thy tender care. In thy pleasant pastures feed us. For our use thy folds prepare. Blessed Jesus, you have bought us, yours we are. Blessed Jesus, you have bought us, yours we are.
We are yours, please befriend us, be the guardian of our way. Keep thy flock from sin, defend us, seek us when we go astray. Blessed Jesus, hear us when we pray. Blessed Jesus, hear us when we pray.
You have promised to receive us, poor and sinful though we be. Have mercy to relieve us, grace to cleanse and power to free. Blessed Jesus, you have loved us, love us still. Blessed Jesus, you have loved us, love us still. You have loved us, love us still. You have loved us, love us still.
Jesus,
Lord, we thank you for these songs. We thank you for this moment that we can spend with you and just lifting your name and listening to the story behind these songs, because this story is all your story. How you inspire us, how you love us, how you forgive us, how you clean us, how you just bring us through joy, you bring us through pain, you bring us through everything. We can totally trust you, and it's so sweet to trust in you. For all these songs and for all the others that you've inspired to humanity, we thank you for that, because the songs ring with us. They stay in our heart. They stay in our minds as we leave this place, and they remind us and give us just a constant awareness of your presence in our lives and your power in our lives and your sovereignty in the universe. So we thank you for that. And so keep us all in the palm of your hand as we go through the next 2 weeks. It'll be 2 weeks until we get together again, but we will be with you through those 2 weeks. And bless our time of fellowship now as we proceed into the foyer. And thank you for all our friends online who are watching all over the place. We are grateful for how you minister to people through song and technology and through your spirit. Bless us all in the name of Jesus. All God's children said, amen. Amen. Thanks so much. I know. God bless.